This lesson is about the production of light. Throughout the lesson, we're going to take a look at 8 different methods of light production. For each one, you want to make sure that you record the name and include a brief description of how light is actually produced using that method, and then provide at least 1 or 2 examples for each method. In order to begin, we have to take a look at some basics of light. Now that includes the idea that light is just converted energy. So if we recall from grade 9, the law of conservation of energy, it's stating that we have a finite amount of energy. We can't create it, we can't destroy it, we can only convert it to one form or another. So when we are producing light energy, we have to be getting it or harnessing it from another source. So for example, if we're looking at a flashlight and it's acting as our converter and we're going to use it with the goal of getting light energy, the idea is there has to be an input energy form. Now, like the flashlight that you have there, obviously its input energy is going to come from the batteries. So if we look at it, we say we have our batteries, which start off as a chemical energy. That chemical energy will then become electrical energy, which will then become heat energy, producing our desired output format, which is obviously light energy. There's also the wasted form that will be in there as well, which is thermal energy. The first method of light production that we're going to take a look at is called incandescence. This is one of the most common forms, as it is in our incandescent light bulbs that most households have. Light is produced in this case when an object is heated. Now, there are a lot of different ways that objects can be heated. One of them is by directly adding thermal energy. So you can see that in the example up here with the heated metal. And that's why heated metals tend to glow, is when that extra thermal energy is added, the electrons of the atoms get excited. And as they get excited, they jump to another orbit and then return back to the original one, releasing that energy in the form of light energy. There are various other methods that can be used to heat an object in order to produce light, and that's friction. We have electricity, and that's a common incandescent light bulb, as you can see here. Electricity comes up, passed through the wires. It is resisted to the point that those electrons bounce off each other and produce light energy in the filament, and the electrons, then electricity, leave the light bulb. And chemical energy can do the same. Some common examples, sparks, candle flames, and a filament in a light bulb. Electric discharge is the second method of light production we're going to talk about today. This is when electrons are getting excited, move to a higher energy state due to collisions. So if we recall back to our Bohr-Rutherford diagrams, we knew that we had our nucleus in the center, and then we had different electron orbits around. Now, when you have an electron in orbit, on that first orbit held 2, if there is energy enough, and in this case it's due to a collision, that electron can get knocked or bumped to a higher energy level. Now, it can't stay there for very long because it's attracted back to the nucleus. So as it goes back down to its original orbit, it releases energy. And that's what is indicated or shown in these diagrams here as well. So you have an electron at its lowest energy state or its natural orbit. Due to a collision, it moves up to a higher energy orbit. So that could be from an X-ray or a collision with another electron. And as it goes and falls back down to its original energy state, you have the emission of light energy. Now, there are 2 kind of major ways that this can happen. There are natural ways and there are artificial. Now, natural can include the phenomena of lightning, static electricity. So if you take a blanket and you move around and you see those little sparks, that's actually electric discharge. Northern lights are also another example of natural electric discharge. And you can see the color spectrum that are released up here. Artificial electric discharge examples would include when we have electricity passing through the gas in neon signs, because as electricity passes through, you have collisions of electrons causing the changing of orbits and then therefore the release of light. The third method of light production we're going to look at is called fluorescence. We're common with those as the long fluorescent light bulbs we see in our classrooms and we often see in office buildings. Now, the way these work is there is a material called phosphors that when they're excited by ultraviolet or UV light, they actually emit white light. So there are basically 3 steps in describing how it works. Now, if we take a look at the diagram down here, and we represent this as our fluorescent light bulb that we see. Three major components is that the first thing, there has to be an electric current through a gas. So we have these endpoints called the electrodes through which electricity is going to come in. Now, once it comes into this point here, this little filament, it then moves through that fluorescent light bulb. Now, the way it does that is there is actually an inert gas inside these bulbs, which is usually argon gas. So argon gas will allow the transfer of the electricity from one end to the other without actually having a reaction. Now, as the electricity is moving from one side to the other, it actually stimulates a little bit of mercury that is inside that light bulb. Now, what happens when mercury has electricity go through it and gets excited? It actually releases UV or ultraviolet light. Now, that ultraviolet light then goes on to come in contact with the phosphor coating. So if we were to take a look and let's say, okay, where would that phosphor coating be? It is all the way around the inside of that light bulb. So the ultraviolet light reacts with the phosphors get excited by it, and then emit the white light. The next method is phosphorescence. Now, this method is somewhat similar to fluorescence in that we have the material phosphors involved, which are absorbing UV light. However, in phosphorescence, these phosphors can also absorb visible light, so to produce white light. Now, another key difference if we're comparing our fluorescence with our phosphorescence is when we have the excited electrons in fluorescence, almost immediately those electrons come back down and release their energy. In phosphorescence, when they're excited, they actually store that energy, and it takes a lot longer for those electrons to come back to their initial state or orbit and then release their energy. And if you look at it, there's actually less energy to be released because in that storage phase, some energy is lost. So a great example of these are the glow-in-the-dark stars and toys that kids put around their rooms, or that you sometimes have as paints that you can put on things that you want to see in the dark. Next up are chemiluminescence and bioluminescence. Chemiluminescence, just as the name implies, chemi is a result of a chemical reaction. Often these are referred to as cold light forms, in that the chemical reactions that are taking place have little or no heat produced. So if we take a look at the common example of glow sticks, if you've ever had one before, you take the stick, you actually hear the snap when you break it, because what's happening is you have two individual chemicals that are stored inside, and there's usually a glass or a thick plastic barrier in between. So by breaking it, you're allowing those two chemicals to mix, which release the energy that produces the light. Oftentimes these are used instead of other light forms for safety reasons, because there is no heat produced. They can be used in areas where there might be flammable products or sparks could ignite a fire or an explosion. So sometimes it's thought of as a safe light as well. Now, the reason we put bioluminescence here as well is it is just an example of chemiluminescence in living organisms. So for example, we could have glowworms and fireflies. There are a lot of animals in the oceans that have chemiluminescence as well. Triboluminescence is kind of a fun method of light production, that it's sparking caused by electrons jumping from one surface to another. So any materials that produce light using triboluminescence have crystal-type molecules that, when they are forcibly moved apart, so whether that's through chewing, or it could be hammering, or it could be hitting the two together through friction, those electrons jump from one part to the another, causing an electric spark. So this happens oftentimes when diamonds are being cut, so to be put into jewelry, happens with quartz. And a neat kind of fun one is lifesavers. Winto green lifesavers only have a material that are crystal-like that produce light using triboluminescence. So if you're to chew them in the bathroom or a dark room in front of a mirror with your mouth open, you'd actually be able to see the sparks inside your mouth. It's also said that you can create triboluminescence using scotch tape. By pulling the two pieces apart, you can see those electrons jumping from one to the other. Light-emitting diodes, are commonly referred to as LEDs, produce light by allowing electric current to flow through semiconductors, which are materials such as silicone that allow for electrons to move in only one direction. So if we look at the circuit down here, you have electrons moving out this way. They're only going to move in this case, from right to left across the semiconductor. And they move that way because on this part of the semiconductor, it's almost as if there are holes. And those holes allow those electrons to move into them. But as the electrons move forward, new electrons come in and replace them from behind so that they can't move backwards. They can only move one direction. Now, the reason people use LEDs and prefer them oftentimes over incandescent bulbs is they don't have a filament. By not having filament means that there is little heat produced because there isn't the resistance that's required in an incandescent bulb to cause the glowing and the light. Therefore, they're also considered much more energy efficient than incandescent bulbs. The other benefit to not having a filament in this type of light bulb is that filaments often break. If you've ever taken a light bulb at home that's burnt out, you shake it and you can hear that filament rattling around. Well, as soon as the filament breaks, you no longer have a complete circuit, therefore you won't have the production of light. Whereas in LEDs, if we don't have a filament up here, there is no filament to break, therefore they often last a lot longer. One downfall, however, is they don't produce a lot of light. So if you think about it, if you've ever seen those LED flashlights, there are many LEDs put side by side in order to produce a similar amount of light to an incandescent bulb. The last method of light production we're going to take a look at are lasers, which is actually an acronym for light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. So the unique thing about lasers is that they do produce waves at the exact same energy level. So if we look at a regular incandescent bulb and we look at the light rays that are coming out, we have large light waves and we have short light waves and we have ones in between, and they're radiating out in all different directions. So we essentially are getting a diffuse light. Whereas lasers, if you look at its production, every single wave is in unison. They're all focused, which results in a very intense light, which allows it to travel a lot farther, but it also means that more energy is getting to the end point, which is why it is often has warning labels on them and are dangerous and can be quite dangerous to your eyes, as you can actually burn your retina because there's so much energy at the end because they're all focused. So make sure that for each method of production throughout the video, which were 8 different methods, you recorded the name with correct spelling of each method, explanation of how light is produced using that method, and 1 or 2 examples for that method.